Welcome, dear guests, and welcome, online viewers. We are here today for a discussion called Is Computer Code Similar to Our Own DNA, and Can AI Be Used to Speed Up Its Evolution? And we are here to welcome our three speakers. I will start with the first one. It's a very famous microbiologist and Nobel Laureate in Chemistry for the CRISPR technology, Emmanuelle Charpentier. Author, entrepreneur, inventor, and investor, Tony Fadell. And cybersecurity expert and CEO of ESET, Richard Marko.
Madina, thank you very much for the introduction. How wonderful to be here with such a special guest. And it's not just coincidence that today is an important date, because today, the next edition of the STARMUS Festival was announced in the morning, and Emmanuelle and Tony, together with me, were part of the press conference when this festival was announced. The festival must be one of the most interesting things happening in the area of science, art, music, where brilliant minds from around the world come together and spend 1 week discussing the pressing issues of the world today and trying to find solutions, but also enjoying the time together. And what was announced today is that the next edition of the STARMUS Festival will take place in Slovakia next May in 2024. Emmanuelle, you are part of STARMUS Festival for a couple of years already. How did you get to be a part of the festival, and what does it mean to you?
Yeah, actually it's a Garrick Israeli, so one of the two founders of STARMUS, who contacted me in 2006 and to ask me whether I would participate in the STARMUS Festival that took place, if I'm not mistaken, in 2017 in Trondheim. And I was very much impressed actually by the line of speakers for this festival, and also I was quite actually interested because now I think next year maybe it will include more speakers that are not astrophysicists, but at the time there were quite a number of astrophysicists, and I find the world of stars very fascinating. Actually, as a microbiologist, our stars are little microbes, so I'm more interested in the macrocosm. Yeah, and I was very much interested as well because of the connection between science, art, and music. And I think for those who did not attend the festival yet, the way it's organized is it's very very inspiring, because the flow of the choice of topics, and there are not only scientists who speak, there are also other influential people, at least was clearly the case in 2017, also economists and other influential figures in other fields. It's organized in a very interesting and sensitive way, whereby also the audience has a chance to really listen to different types of music, quite eclectic range of of music styles, and put together in a very inspiring way, where I think it forces the mind to be open a bit differently, and to new topics of science the audience has never had the chance to hear about, or new types of music that is also connected in a very innovative fashion. So I was actually very happy to participate in the STARMUS Festival, and I'm still happy to be here.
Mm-hmm. Thank you very much. Sir Brian May today said that he doesn't see science and art as a two different things. He sees it as a same continuum of, let's say, mental activity of a human being. So, Tony, you are just like Emmanuel, a part of the SARMUS board. And so, how do you decide about what is the topic of the festival? How do you decide what is the place where the festival is taking place?
Sure. Well, thank you everyone for coming out. It's good. Thank you for hosting us. You know, the way I think about STARMUS is a lot the way Emmanuel just said. It's a very special and eclectic group of people, intellectuals and artists and who get together, and engineers and designers who get together and have a weeks-long discussion. But what happens for us is that, you know, we get to go all around the world. We get to speak all around the world. We get to see things and talk to different people. But when we come together, we want to come together in a place, to answer your question about place, we want to come together in a place where it's going to also teach us something. And so, you know, we've always, you know, I go to London, I go to Paris, I go to San Francisco, whatever, all around and speak. But we like to, as STARMUS, find new places to go to, new, not, you know, not the typical places. And when we were asked when we were in Armenia, actually, Armenia was the last, Yerevan was the last STARMUS, we were there and we had representatives from Slovakia there, they were like, can you come to Bratislava? Can you come to our country and do the same thing that you're doing here in Armenia here? And we're like, wait a second. So the first thing we're like, how many times have we all gone here? One or zero or very close to some very small number as opposed to somewhere else we've been 20, 30 times. We're like, that's the first indication. Secondly, you wanted us here. And because STARMUS is such an interesting festival, it takes and very challenging festival in a way, it takes very interesting people to want to have it, right? Because it's not just your normal like sporting event or this or whatever. It takes a very interesting audience who's very curious. And so when you have an interesting place with people who are interested in what we're talking about, and we want to learn as well about the place and the people and the ideas and the challenges here, that's when magic happens. Magic happens when it's a two-way conversation and we can all learn from each other. That's why we come together as a group in STARMUS, and that's why we come together in interesting places around the world so that we can all learn from each other, because we, you know, we get to see all the typical things and read about all the typical things in the media or go there. Let's go to someplace else. Let's have an adventure together with interesting people. So that's how we pick the place. STARMUS for me, again, you know, just like Emmanuel said, just interesting board members, interesting speakers. There's always something, to learn. But even more interesting is that you can also have a lot of fun, because the people, we're not like corporate 500, you know, Fortune 500 people. We have fun, and then we have fun on stage, and you know, we're singing. Even us, engineers and scientists and designers, we're up there singing too with the group. It's really, it's hard to explain. You should go to the website and check it out. But it is really fun, and it's a group kind of activity for young people and older people. Remember, at the end of the day, STARMUS is about science communication. What we try to do is we try to bring very interesting people to interesting places to communicate the latest and greatest in science and why we're passionate about science and the arts, and to get younger generations to also want to join in, not just STARMUS, but join in the types of work we do, because the only way we're going to move the human race forward is by getting more and more generations to come onto this side. It's not just about sports, it's not about social media and influencers and all that bullshit. It's about literally doing things and creating the world in a new way in our image so that we can further our species.
Tony, you definitely look like a person who can enjoy time and enjoy.
I like to have a good time.
Emmanuelle, you are well known for creating or making a discovery that leads to ability to do gene editing, and it's called like CRISPR-Cas9. I will not attempt to explain the abbreviation. It's pretty cryptic, but I think the story of the CRISPR itself is very interesting.
Yes, indeed. It's very interesting. Yeah. So bacteria actually have a lot of fun, but not always, as every organism on the planet. They can also be infected by viruses. So I guess by now you have not missed the fact that we can be infected by viruses. And we have to defend ourselves against infections by bacteria and viruses. But bacteria can be infected by viruses. Viruses can also be infected by viruses. And they have evolved very interesting defense systems to cope with those attacks. So they have a kind of a security program to be able to survive. And you have various mechanisms existing. We are far from understanding all the mechanisms that they have developed to cope with the multiple attacks by invader genomes. But one of the systems that was discovered over the past more than 30 years is called CRISPR, and it's an adaptive immune system. And it's actually very much evolving. So it's a system that has evolved in multiple subsystems and that use very sophisticated small molecular machineries that are composed of proteins and RNA molecules and that are going to recognize site-specifically the genome of a virus infecting a bacterium. And that system that can really destroy the DNA of the virus. And at the end of the day, the viral DNA cannot replicate, the viral particles cannot be formed. And so this is the dead end of the virus. So this is the way the CRISPR system works. And this very sophisticated machinery that is composed of an enzyme that can cleave the DNA and that is in a way programmed through an RNA molecule that can recognize specifically the DNA of the virus, was harnessed as a very powerful genetic technology that would allow to actually edit the genes and genomes at will. So the idea of recoding life using this technology, and indeed it has been used over the past 10 years in a very successful manner, as a technology that allows to modify genes and their expression in a large variety of cells and organisms, actually as long as we can modify the genes and their expression in cells and organisms in an ethical manner. But this has really revolutionized the world of life sciences through really a tool that originates from bacteria, like a lot of molecular biology tools that have been used and developed over the past 50 years. Most of them originate from research that is done on bacteria and viruses. So all the enzymes that have been discovered that allow to clone the DNA, recombine the DNA, amplify the DNA, PCR, which now you are familiar with for, detecting whether you are infected with the virus or not. A lot of technology originates from basic science, and this is the luck we had in the lab to work specifically on a certain bacterial species called Streptococcus pyogenes that can cause diseases in humans, and the system CRISPR-Cas9 of this specific bacterial species is specifically powerful. And over the past 10 years, it has been developed into multiple versions of the tool, with really tremendous applications, so very fast applications. After a couple of months, scientists could show right away that it was allowing to modify genes in model organisms that are used in research and development, such as flies, fish, mice, then human cells, which is quite very important for all the development of the biomedical field, and also applications in gene editing in small organoids that are also important for the drug discovery business. So it had had a tremendous implication in speeding up the understanding of the function of genes, being able to develop models and to find screens, to find targets for a new medicine, develop models of diseases that are more close to the clinical situation and that allow to test medicine in development. And it has also been developed as a direct medicine to treat human genetic disorders. This was one of my dream, in a way, before we even understood in my lab how the system was working. And de facto, it's now really used to treat patients with certain genetic blood disorders by combining the gene editing technology with cell therapy, so cell replacement, and it's working. And soon it's going to be approved, hopefully, by FDA as really a medicine that can be put on the market. It's also used a lot in cancer immunotherapy. So the idea to repurpose the immune cells of a patient to target cancer cells and kill them. So in this case, the repurposing of the immune cells that are really programmed to recognize the cancer cells and kill them have to be programmed through genetic engineering, and CRISPR is used, and it's also happening to treat patients with certain types of leukemia. And there are other development of the technology to treat metabolic disorders such as diabetes, so we have a lot of research in the field, and to use also the technology directly in vivo as a medicine that will be injected directly into the patient. And you have also applications in agriculture for the production of very clean and safe plant crops that have been genetically engineered in a fashion that would be what nature could actually engineer as really changing the DNA at really at the nucleotide level and allowing to produce plant crops that are, let's say, more clean than the genetically modified plants that were used with former technologies, and also more clean than using chemicals, pesticides, or these breeding technologies that end up with a large recombination of the genome. So it's very very exciting time. One thing I would like to say, because it's very critical, is that when you have a technology that that comes like this new, it's also, and this was a case of CRISPR, the reason why it developed so fast, it's also thanks to the fact that there was a need for this technology, but other technologies that were also necessary for the success of CRISPR technology were in place. So all these technologies for high throughput, genome sequencing, all the era of genomics, omics, proteomics, the ability also to do some imaging on cells with a tremendous effort and developments of all the macroscopy technologies, the ability as well to grow cells, which we could not culture 20 years ago, the stem cells, induced pluripotent stem cells, hematopoietic stem cells, a lot of effort in the culture of primary cells in a safe way, organoids. So a lot of technologies that made CRISPR really a very, very exciting technology that developed extremely fast. So it's really extremely exciting. For the young audience, what is really what people of my generation are very frustrated about, because we are not at the bench any longer, is that all the questions that we were asking and which we could not answer now can be answered. And the development of the technology in the biotechnology field for fundamental science purposes or application is remarkable. And it's really changing science that requires also new types of scientists to know how to deal with the technologies. Lots of big data that will require maybe an intelligent most likely artificial intelligence that will be also, how do you say, designed by humans and controlled by the human brain, so that we can also use, you know, good tools to really for the purpose of science.
Well, that's really amazing. I believe the research regarding CRISPR started maybe at the end of 80s or something like that, and then it took more than 20 years to get to the discovery, and then since then it just exploded, right? Mm-hmm. And when I was reviewing some of the details of the CRISPR system, I was really so surprised that it's so similar to some of the technologies we used in cybersecurity, coincidentally 30 years ago. So simply you had some kind of database of some search patterns that you were then matching against the code that you were examining, and if there was a match, then you said, like, this is a computer virus. And computer viruses, that was a topic that really kind of fascinated me back then. I was a student, and then Stephen Hawking said, like, I think computer viruses should count as life. And so, you know, that really brought even more attention to it. But so when we are now touching this world of technologies, Tony, you are, for you, everything started with iPod, or not really?
Well, it started before then, but iPod was what I was known, you know, where I started getting known. But before that, I worked at a company called General Magic in 1991, 92, 93, where we invented the iPhone just 15 years too early. So we did the whole iPhone development. Literally, there's a movie about it called General Magic that you should watch. But we did all that, and it was the wrong time. And we had to wait, like you said, with CRISPR, you had all the things around it to then let CRISPR, you know, gene sequencing and all these kind of things. When we were creating the iPhone 15 years too early, there was no internet. There was no mobile networks. There was no mobile data networks. There wasn't even digital phone lines. There was nobody understood what email was yet, or emojis, which we invented. No one understood what downloadable games or online travel would be. Like, we had a chat. We had all of this stuff in 1992, 93, pre-internet. And we thought we were going to conquer the world. It took 15 years later, when all of those, Wi-Fi didn't exist, all of those things were finally in place, and people had the pain. Back in 91, people didn't know what email was like, right? You know, so they didn't know why they needed it. We'd show it to people, they go, it looked like something alien. They're like, what are you talking about? Messages that you send across the thing with animations on, they didn't get it. You know, 15 years later, when we were carrying an iPod in your pocket for mobile entertainment, when you were carrying a cell phone with digital communications, whether that's voice or text, and you were carrying a laptop for browsing and doing productivity stuff and gaming for the most part, you brought three devices everywhere you went. And people are like, this is painful. I got to take all these chargers and batteries, and I got to work with all these different things. So the iPhone shows up with all the other stuff around, so the pain was there. Hey, Garrick. What do you teleport here? So literally we had the pain, and we had everything around us, and then we could just create what we created 15 years earlier, and everybody wanted it. So it's, you know, you have to also have the right infrastructure, the right environment, and people understanding what you're trying to solve. Yeah. Back then we were solving for problems we didn't even have. So, you know, there's a lineup of all these technologies that it finally comes in. And as you said, you know, CRISPR's been worked on for 20 years, and then it finally took off. Look at AI. AI's been worked on. I remember working on AI in labs in the 80s, right? And I remember it from the 70s. It's been worked on. And literally, AI's been around for 10 years now in products and everything else. We just didn't discover it as people until 5-6 months ago. Like, literally, oh my God, this AI stuff's real. It's been real for a while. We just now finally realized it when we put a face on it and we could talk to it. So, yeah. So it's just really interesting how, even though we might have the right ideas, it takes a lot of things, society to get ready for it, you know, the base technology around it. And now why is AI everywhere? It's because we have the mobile networks and we have the mobile phones and we have the Wi-Fi and we have the internet and we have all the data sets. And now AI can actually be the AI we see today, which we envisioned years and years ago, just like we envisioned the iPhone and just like you envisioned CRISPR and those things.
Right, so if iPod was like the beginning of iPhone later, so it looks like it all started with entertainment, right? With music.
Yeah, actually, that's the funny thing is, you know, people were trying to make digital smartphones before the iPhone. But what they were doing was they were taking business applications and shrinking them down, like Microsoft Word. Microsoft tried to make a phone. BlackBerry was, you know, they had the CrackBerry with the phone. But it was about business. And it was always, let's do more business. And, you know, typical consumers like, well, I don't want to do more email. I don't want to work when I go home. I want to have fun. And so the iPhone would have only been created if the iPod happened. And so the iPod happened, and then the iPhone happened, because it was born out of consumer focus, digital entertainment, and we kept growing it into what would become the iPhone, as opposed to what everybody else was trying, which was trying to take business productivity tools, being very practical, and trying to cram it into consumers' lives. And they're like, I don't want this. You know, I want something fun, something that's interesting. And so that's, you also have to worry about the vector it's coming from. You know, at General Magic, we weren't trying to make a productivity device. We were making a consumer device and about sending notes to your family and sharing emotions and stuff like that with them. Very different way of thinking.
Right. The question today is computer code similar to our DNA? So let's start with DNA, Emmanuel. What really DNA is? What is the function of DNA? What do we know about DNA?
We know a lot. So it's been now since, I think, the 40s of the last century that it was discovered that DNA is a carrier of the genetic information. I guess up to the 60s, maybe, the idea was there will be some genes, so that are composed of a piece of DNA, and that the genes code for proteins, with an intermediate molecule that is a messenger RNA. So the genes are transcribed into messenger RNA that are translated into proteins. But then it came very obvious 50 years ago that this was not only as simple as it looked like, and that you had for sure sequences of DNA in between the genes that are supposed to not code for anything, but actually you find some pieces of DNA encoding RNA molecules that will not code for proteins, but have a function like the CRISPR RNAs. So the RNA molecules of the CRISPR system, they don't code for proteins, but they have in a way a coding function because they are really part of a mechanism and they act and are essential for the mechanism to work.
They were called junk DNA, if I remember.
It was all called junk.
Exactly. Ah, we know these. Stuff in the middle.
Exactly.
That's junk.
Junk DNA.
It was called junk DNA.
And then you have all the epigenetics phenomenon that are also all the evolution of the DNA that is not belonging to the genes but outside the genes, and that are also essential because these are the species of DNA that contains you know, activators or repressors of expression, and also the way the termination of the transcription of those genes are regulated. So it's way complex. I think it's a lot of evolution compared to the computer, that a very new field compared to the billions of years of organisms on the planet. As a matter of fact, with CRISPR, what is also interesting is that by the understanding that, you know, it was really essential to understand the mechanisms of life, looking at the diversity of organisms in the planet, this is really by looking at the diversity that we could really understand what was the function of CRISPR, because all the bacteriologists in the 60s, 70s, 80s were working primarily on two types of model organisms, so specific bacterial species, Escherichia coli and Bacillus subtilis, with all the screens that they had done, everyone was, but how come they did not find this immune system, defense system, because they found others, but not CRISPR. And this is because in those specific bacterial strains they were working with, the system was silenced, actually. It was existing by silenced. But this is really by looking at, you know, the large variety of bacterial species that they could find some CRISPR systems active, and they could understand what was the function of CRISPR. And CRISPR allows now to look genetically at the evolution of the world by being able to do genetics in organisms, which we could not really do genetics prior to having the tool CRISPR-Cas. So we understand more about DNA, but you know, if you look even in the bacterial world, we are far from, in macrobiological world, I mean, we are far from knowing all the bacterial and archaeal species existing, far from knowing all the viral species existing. And then sometimes we know only 1 or 2% of the functions of genes. There are lots of genes and junk DNA for which we have no idea what they are doing. There are no similarities with other genes existing.
Right.
You have the world that people don't know, specifically in the water, you have a lot of viruses that can infect other viruses. And when you look at the genome, it doesn't look like anything that is known. People have no idea what the genes are coding for. So it's really fascinating, and lots of things to be discovered. I think absolutely. It will require a lot of human beings to understand everything, lots of AI maybe, to guide the human beings to...
The way I think of DNA, or the way I think mm-hmm. of the human system, and this is you'll forget any more than I'll ever know about the subject. But the way I look at it is DNA and just above it, that's like the hardware of a computer.
Yeah, exactly.
And then that's the genome is kind of the hardware of the computer, and the epigenome, which is what you're speaking about, the epigenome on top of it, that's like the software of the system. Mm-hmm. And so we know what digital hardware looks like, and we're starting to learn what quantum hardware looks like, right? But we're talking billions of years of creating this hardware in biology systems. We're reverse engineering it, and we don't even really know. Like, luckily we have CRISPR to help us to try to tear this apart and understand, but we don't even understand how it's evolved and where it's got to today on the hardware. Then we go up to the software level, the epigenome, and we have freaking no idea. Like, we keep talking like, oh, if we change this one little gene down here, this one nucleotide, boom, all this stuff's gonna change. It's like, no. Oh, we're gonna understand, like we talked about earlier, intelligence. We're going to make super babies, intelligent this and that. Like, don't believe everything you read. We are so far from really understanding. Unlike in the digital world where we created it all ourselves, as opposed to it was evolved over millions of years, we can understand this. And unfortunately, for all the cybersecurity people can go in and hack it because it was made by humans. You know, we need like almost an alien to create a computer so we can't hack it, so we don't understand how it was built, because we're trying to hack our bodies, and you know, we're only sort of successful at that in mm-hmm. certain ways, right? There's all kinds of anomalies that we introduce when we do it.
Well, Emmanuel, when you were saying that there are probably so many viruses that we are not even aware of, and bacteria and maybe other organisms, then I was thinking, hopefully when I go to our cybersecurity lab and I ask my guys, what knowledge do we have about all the computer viruses that exist in the world, they will not tell me like, well, we know some of them, but there is so many that we don't know. Hopefully this is not the case here. Yeah. It's a different world, but still, looking at the DNA, the thing that surprises me as someone working in computer science is that it's basically like a digital system, that it uses four letters and then a long combination of the letters to encode basically anything. So this is, in computer we use only two letters, well, hardware uses only two letters, like higher voltage, lower voltage, something like that. Here, for some reason, nature decided for four letters. So this is probably to some extent similar than this encoding of proteins, and I learned that there are these chiplets that are being used to encode it's very similar to some of the techniques we use in programming real computers, so that was really interesting. But still, the real computers are quite different from these biological systems. So the first computers...
Humans heal themselves. Biological systems heal themselves. Our computers, once they bust, you get one memory bit wrong, it's gone, right? The power supply's failing, our stuff is very fragile. Evolution has done a great job. We're highly unevolved when it comes to digital technology.
Well, indeed, as you say, when we say that there's a mutation in a gene, for example, then probably most of us would feel like, well, that sounds dangerous. Hopefully it's not my DNA and so on. But the reality is that these mutations are happening all the time, and they are probably important part of the whole evolution, right? And yet, mutation of a single letter in the DNA is not causing a major problem. Usually it can in some cases, but usually it might create a small modification which might be beneficial or not. The time will tell, natural selection. But we don't have this opportunity with computers. Just like Tony said, single bit and everything is over. Blue screen of death or something like that, right?
Right. It's got a little bit more resilient since I started. I remember always having a floppy drive saying save, 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 because now it's really hard to lose work. Before, you could lose work. Years worth of work in a minute or a second. It's a little better, but not like humans or biological systems.
Yeah, well, it simply looks like this could be an inspiration for us to, in the way we further develop the IT industry, right? How this all works. And maybe we already have some sign there, because the AI that was mentioned already several times here is not exactly like that. It's some kind of artificial neural network, and usually when you hear a little bit more information about such model, as it is being called, you hear what is the number of parameters that are used by the model to work, and those parameters are much less sensitive to modification. When you change a single parameter, probably not much will happen. Of course it can, but from this perspective it probably reminds us of this robustness of the biological systems more. But there are other similarities and maybe even more differences. When we look at the computers, many of us heard the Moore's law, that is saying that every 5 years or what was it, I don't remember, the number of transistors on the chip will double, that will create higher computational power. And this empiric rule surprisingly was true for decades. And so we were getting more computational power. With biological systems, it's a different story. There are these chemical reactions going on in the cell, but the chemical reactions are not so fast usually, right? I was checking how long it takes to replicate a DNA, and I noticed something 200 letters per minute or something like that. So it's not fast compared to transferring data over internet or in the computer. It doesn't compare. But what is happening with a biological system is that it's so parallel, right? There are so many chemical reactions happening all the time in the cell, and there are
they're happening slowly, but they're happening also very efficiently. These big computers take a ton of energy, a ton of heat. We just have to eat a little bit of food. Right? We just have to eat a little bit of food. We're processing much better than a lot of these computers out there with just a little bit of energy, and you're not sweating all the time, and you're we are very envious of the biological world and the digital world because of how effective and efficient. Think of your nervous system. We can react pretty, we maybe not react as fast as a computer system in certain instances, but we can react and do a lot of things much more efficiently than any digital system, right? In fact, the way we record videos and record photos is absolutely the wrong way to do it digitally. We're actually trying to now replicate the way the eye and the brain does it for the next generation of cameras, and they're already starting to hit. They're called neuromorphic cameras, and so and we're also doing. I'm working on neuromorphic processors, so that we actually have. We're actually going back to analog. In a lot of ways, we're going, and this is what quantum is as well. Is we're going from digital back to analog, so we can get the right efficiencies and faster speeds. Because we can't do it with the digital technology we have today. We're actually going backwards to analog, where we all started. And it's pretty interesting to see, you know, the pendulum swing for us to try to make biological-like systems with silicon.
Well, I think let's jump directly to the big topic in the last couple of months. The chat GPT that everybody talks about, and it's a neural model that brought a revolution to interaction between general public and artificial neural networks. And they broke records in how quickly they were growing the number of users. I think they are over 1 billion of users right now after just several months of making it available to the public. And Tony, like, what is your experience with chat GPT? Do you use it? And what do you think about it?
On my way here today, I used it yesterday. I use it every day. I'm studying about it. I literally, about three, four months ago, I dropped everything and just said I was going to learn about it more, about what that LLM, or large language model technology, is. At Nest, when we were doing Nest, we had AI inside of our thermostats. So in our thermostats, we actually put AI in it, but we just couldn't tell people it was AI because it would scare people. Now, you could, if you have a company and you don't say AI, you're like, no one cares. Back then, if I said AI, rah, they're running, right? So it's amazing how society changes. But we've been using and we've been benefiting from AI in many ways over the last 10 years, even longer than that, maybe 15 years, in small ways. Now, what we've done with these large language models, and the reason why I stopped doing what I was doing just because I wanted to get into this full force, is that it is the first time when we can start to interact with it like a human. The other ways we weren't interacting with like humans. And so this is where all the modalities shift, all the ways we think about what we can do with it, how people perceive it. And so it is moving incredibly fast. And literally there are papers and new versions of these AIs coming out the next day. Not 2 months later. I went away on vacation for 2 weeks and the fundamentals had dramatically changed, and I made some different assumptions. In 2 weeks, I changed my thought on certain topics in AI. It is moving that fast, and it's moving that fast around the world. So, you know, there's a lot coming. It reminds me of the early days of the internet or the early days of the smartphone or the iPhone.
Right.
But it's even more so than that because everybody can work on it. You don't need a network. The network's already there. The phones are there. The app stores are there. It's just literally an interesting way of adding intelligent assistance to all of the programs that are out there, as well as giving you new assistance that we've never seen before. So they can have personalities. The AIs can have personalities. I can make a digital replication of me. We can make a different replication of this audience. If we take all your data, now that will represent all of us and you can talk to it as opposed to what's going on. There are so many interesting ways of using this type of technology, and not just command line that we're seeing today and talking to it. You can do it with imaging, with cameras, you can do it with audio, these kinds of things. And it's just absolutely, utterly fascinating, and it can be scary. And it's not scary because AIs itself are going to take over. Not for me, I don't think AIs are going to take over by themselves. Not anytime soon, at least. It's when people use AIs against people. That's when it's scary. So you know, everybody's worried about the one AI that's going to take over. That's it's going to be people using AIs like deepfakes or what have you to then reprogram us, the biological robots, to do their bidding.
Right. Emmanuelle, did you try ChatGPT? Did you try it? Did you try it?
Oh, I did not try ChatGPT, you see, because...
because how many in here have tried it? How many in here have tried it? Wait, raise your hands. How many tried it? Okay, yeah, that's a pretty good. That's
you see, it's because I'm very
that's
busy.
5 months.
You see?
Yeah, you're right.
Because I rely a lot on myself. because I can do better than ChatGPT. That's why.
You should try it.
but actually, in science, I was thinking maybe some. You know, some young scientists, when they are alone, you know, at the weekend, which is extremely rare in our days, maybe ChatGPT will be a good, you know, a good person to chat with. But de facto, in science, it's used to obviously help writing some articles. And you have some journals, like already the famous journal Nature, which introduced in their, instructions to the authors, the fact that in materials and methods, the scientists should, mention if they have been using ChatGPT to help them writing their article, which I'm sure will be coming more and more, which is, I don't know, maybe not bad per se, because in any case, all the data will be, all the saying will be verified. And you know, when you write a scientific article, you have to put a reference for every sentence you write. But I see indeed some young scientists having difficulties to write. It's less and less their strength to maybe, you know, use ChatGPT to help them, you know, pre-writing a piece and maybe, you know, not being in front of a white page, but helping them to have a bit of a structure. But in any case, in science, you will always have to verify everything that comes from ChatGPT. Sometimes, I did not do it myself. Some people in my lab did it. You know, they asked some questions, and the answers were relatively not very smart or very much inaccurate.
Right. So, it's a master's student, not a PhD.
Exactly. Or a bachelor's student.
Or a bachelor's. one thing about AI, and we have to talk about it because we just talked about DNA and evolution, is we are coming up on a world where if and when AIs can self-replicate and they can self-learn. Today, people think AIs self-learn. They don't right now. They do batch learning. There's a way that they learn, and it's not the way we learn. If they start to learn the way we learn and they can self-replicate, we are already in the community talking about evolutionary species of AI and how they start to cooperate or how they start to compete, how we have different types of relationships between them, how they're going to deceive each other. It becomes all of this like human nature, but in a digital form for evolution. That is a topic that is actually being discussed right now, because these things, if we allow them, and I don't believe we should, they should not be able to self-replicate without a human in the loop. They should not be able to self-learn without a human in the loop to stop things, to press the button, and to know what's going on. We can let these things actually compete against each other, replicate, and then literally fight each other, go to war with each other, and do the things humans do unabetted when we have legal systems for humans, we have morals, ethics, values, we have governance regulations, we have all these laws to kind of put the cap on human behavior. We need to do the same thing with AI behavior. If we let these things get out of the bag, this is a bad thing. This is an absolutely bad thing. We cannot have these things self-evolve, because we do not know. If you talk to any people working on LLMs today, they don't know how they all work. They're surprised by how they work. Until we understand them very well and we understand the data sets that we're training them with. Today we're training them with the world of data sets. Yeah. Mm-hmm. We're not training with the best of humanity's data. We're training with all of humanity's data, the good and the bad. We need to understand the the data sets, make sure it's the best of humanity, we make sure there's rules, we make sure it's humans are in the loop so they don't self-replicate, they do not self-learn, so that we can then stay in control of these things. If we do not do that, we will let evolution happen out on the web, out between these systems, and you will see the worst of human nature, because these things are just the reflections of us, evolve faster than us, and you're going to see the worst of human nature come out, as we've seen when we don't have laws, when we have corruption, when we have these things. We need to get ahead of this.
So, Emmanuelle, and basically all the scientists, when you are working on the research, you are asking questions, how this works, why this behaves this way, and so on. So it would be, in my opinion, it would be amazing if you could go to, for example, ChatGPT and ask those questions, and you would get the answers like, this is the way it works. Nobody knew before, but now I'm telling you because you are asking. That would be beautiful. But are we already there? Well, probably most of you guess what the answer is, but I did an experiment before coming to the discussion today, and I asked the ChatGPT 4.0, the latest version, the question, can you design an experiment that would uncover the nature of dark matter? And ChatGPT, in this, you know, very positive and excited way, replied, sure, and then started some kind of disclaimer that dark matter is complicated and so on, and then there were 8 points, starting with you need to define what is the goal of your experiment, then you need to, there are some experiments that exist in the world that look promising and you can give it a try, and those were listed, then you need to analyze the results very carefully to see what happens, and then of course you need to interpret the results properly. So it sounded more like a excellent assistant, you know, like if you don't know how the work of a scientist should look like, then you will quickly get an indication. Maybe you can learn about some existing experiments, but it doesn't seem to be really providing some new insight. It's more like, Tony, you said, like a reflection maybe of
it's,
what...
It's a reflection of us. It's not going to come up with... It might come up with new things that will come together. They might bring new pieces together, but it's not going to discover new pieces that's not there. It doesn't have sensory input like we have sensory input. We have 5 senses. We have 10 million senses in our bodies. But anyways, it doesn't have that kind of input. The other thing to understand is that these AI, if you do not, if you do not allow them to have the right data sets, if they do not have the right data sets, they're like kids who are not trained well by their parents. Okay? So today, when we train large language models, we take all, like I said, the world of, if we were to take your kid, and everyone's probably got kids or knows kids, if you took the world's data and you put all of it into the kid, all of it, and you say, now I don't want you to do this, I don't want you to do this, I don't want you to do it all by subtractive, and you think you subtracted everything out of it. That's the way large language models are trained today. We want to go the other way, the way we train our children today, which is you go to this school, you get this kind of data, you have this kinds of experience, you've gone to work here, you've trained under these professionals, what have you, and you create a CV. I want the CV of these AI agents. I want to be able to hire and fire these AI agents, right? I want to know who they are. Look, you hire people every day. Today, we hire people every day, and sometimes we hire them virtually, and they work virtually. Yeah. Tomorrow, are those people you're hiring virtually just an AI? Basically, I replicated myself 10 times. I've hired myself out, my AI agent, 10 times, and you're interacting with them over Zoom, and they're doing work for you. And I've now leveraged myself 10 ways. And we're like,
virtual works fine. So how do you know it's a real person? I want real CVs, whether it's a digital CV for a digital agent or a CV for me. I want to be able to double check it. I want to see what's inside it so I know I want to hire it.
So maybe you want to replicate you in a sense, but you probably don't want to replicate the account that you, where you receive your pay, right? You want to collect the, for all the avatars. The time is running really quickly, and there are so many more interesting topics that we can go to here, but I think this is the good time for the audience here to ask a few questions. So in case you have a question, then please raise your hand and you will be given a microphone and you can ask the question. And on the way there, while you have a time to think about it, it's like maybe the ChatGPT and state of AI is maybe not the next level from a perspective that it will just miraculously solve mysteries that we struggle to uncover, even though they, of course, these tools can help us tremendously. But they can be used for good and bad. They can help school children to write essays, for example, but they can help the cyber criminals to write fake emails, phishing emails that would look just like being written by your friend and simply target the content in a way that it's basically impossible to distinguish unless you spend a lot of time trying to follow traces, you know, like on the internet, where did it come from, check with your friend, did you really write it, and so on. So it is creating a real problem as for what is genuine, what is real, what is just fake created by these amazing new tools, right? Mm-hmm. Yeah, that's
powerful, powerful stuff. Mm.
Hello, good evening. My name is Milata. I am organic chemist. And according my opinion, we talk about an artificial intelligence. It is comparing learned data, past. We are comparing two bits, 0, 1, in computer science. It is the past, analyzing of the data. Also in genes, the four characters we are looking for, composition and so on, but it is past. What is your opinion about future, about synthesis, about experimental science and use the artificial intelligence in such a point of view?
Thank you very much. I think, Tony, you are probably always ready to answer this kind of question.
Yeah, I'm ready.
Yeah, you are visionary.
So when it comes to this, I can point to architecture, and I can point to mechanical design. So what we do is we give parameters that we want a structure to, certain types of parameters we want a structure to do, and we ask the computer to give us 25 different generative models. It's called generative architecture. We look at these 25 different models, and then we pick one, and then we optimize more on that, as opposed to, okay, we're going to draw a typical one and then do the simulations and find out where it's at. We actually ask it to generate for us based on some set of parameters. That is already happening in chemistry. We're already doing it in material science. We're saying, as you can see, there's AlphaFold. AlphaFold now is being able to then take all the proteins and fold them in every single way and predict how the folding happens. And now we can start to see molecule-to-molecule interactions because it's doing predictive ways. So we can start to narrow down instead of the old, as we know in chemistry and those kinds of things, it's a lot of like intuition and you do a lot of trial and error. Biology is that as well. Now we're going to actually be able to design experiments that was already synthesized or generated on a computer with these intelligent agents with us, and being able to then narrow our test set, and then we refine from there as opposed to these wide things and just taking stabs in the dark. We're taking drugs, old drugs, and retargeting them
and running them through AIs. This is not new. This has been happening for five to 10 years now. We're taking old drugs and retargeting them and trying to understand why there was serious reactions in the body. Why didn't they work? Can we retarget them for other types of conditions? This stuff in generative AI, not just, we saw the Midjourney and generate, you know, interesting graphs, you know, photos or generate music. It's generating, it's not just generating new chemicals, it's generating new reaction series. It's generating new types of architecture and structures and helping us to be better. So we co-evolve with our technology that we create if we choose to. And we are going to be making better and better things because we're going to be able to, those people who want to embrace those tools, just like when we had CAD, computer-aided design, and MATLAB, and all these other things. This is just the next step in that. And we're going to be generating not just images and sounds, but all kinds of different things that we create today.
Right. Emmanuel, what is your wish for how AI can help you in your work or in your life? What would really make a difference for you?
Actually, it was what was said. I mean, for example, in the field of biology, AI has been already existing for the past 20 years. I mean, it's what we call bioinformatics in a way.
Right.
With a lot of gene profiling, protein profiling, that technologies that have evolved tremendously thanks to bioinformatic tools, whether you call it AI or, yeah, or not AI. It's a little bit what was said, actually. Even AlphaFold could also not be called AI, but just another bioinformatic tool existing. But I think what I would like to see, and this is what we will see, it takes years, but it will, AI, whatever we call that is AI, will be part of more and more of the drug discovery and the life of scientists. Because, even as basic scientists, we want to understand the mechanisms of life, but it's quite complex. So when we have tools that allow to, generate based on data sets that have been verified or have been hypothesized and verified, that help us a little bit giving, some directions of, where exactly we could focus, even though the predictions are a little bit, not always, accurate, but this is our role as scientists to do the experimental work to show that indeed it works. But it's tremendously helpful because you have no idea how much data scientists, but even clinicians, based on the data of genome sequences, the number of data generated, and frankly, we are lost. We have no idea how to deal with all those data.
Yes.
For sure, all the bioinformatics, including AI, is of tremendous help and is very much, evolving. I mean, I have a small lab, and a third of my lab is our bioinformaticians, actually. This is really part of the daily life of scientists. A biologist has a hard time to do, to really carry on successfully a project if there is not, bioinformatics behind, because we do a lot of genomics, proteomics. And the technologies evolve so fast as well. We go to the single cell, single molecule level. We have lots of data, and you need intelligent tools, intelligent AI. So it's as you said, it's like for everything. We will see it in biology, but also other sectors. You use artificial intelligence, but that is smartly trained by humans, which decide which data sets are processed by the artificial intelligence and also can control the parameters that are used to analyze the data sets and what are the goals, with regard to the analysis of the data sets. And this, for sure, we will see a lot of developments thanks to bioinformatics, AI, whatever you call it.
Right. Well, it looks like we are using better and more effectively simply the raw power and all the technologies that are available right now to make some concepts that existed for years, maybe even for decades in artificial intelligence, more efficient, like more powerful. But maybe we will need to do a change or like advance in the design how these networks really operate, and we will maybe need to be further inspired by biological systems, by biological neurons, to really get to the level that could be comparable to the power of a human brain from a perspective of inventing new things, inventing, discovering or uncovering mysteries. So I think the time is quite up. I'm sure there might be more questions, but the time is limited. So let me finish this discussion with a question. There are young people in the audience, more young people watching this discussion. And so imagine you are 15 or 17 years old and you are deciding about your future career. Would you change anything in your decisions that you did when you were 15 or 17 years old, based on the information you know right now, based on what you see, how the science and research has developed in the last whatever years? Emmanuelle.
No, I think I'm very happy of the decision I made, specifically that really, frankly, 25, 30 years ago, no one would think that, you know, you could sequence genomes so fast. All the technologies that we deal with now, I think 30 years ago, no one could ever imagine that those technologies would be existing now, really, frankly. So it's going super, super fast. And I think, as maybe I said earlier today, for the young generation, even the biology field is really even more exciting, because now we can go further with the understanding of the mechanisms of life. And we still need really hardcore scientists, extremely well trained. For example, for CRISPR, this is the basic idea of discovering this specific CRISPR-Cas9 system, is that in contrast to the dogma that you had a CRISPR protein and a CRISPR RNA, for this specific CRISPR-Cas9 system, there was another RNA involved. And actually, when we did bioinformatics, because my idea was to focus first on this other, on the two RNAs in parallel, because they were encoded on the genome in the vicinity of, so very close vicinity. And the idea was to see whether by any chance there would not be any interactions, but the bioinformatic tools could not detect these interactions, because interactions was, it's a bit complicated, but it was at the level of some repeats, which the bioinformatic tools could not really detect. But I detected it. So, but in any case, you need a very, very well-trained scientist to carry on, and the basic research, and also the research that is ongoing in biotechs and in pharmaceutical industry. So as much as we deal with very powerful technologies, we need scientists who can really use the technology, develop the technology further, and really do the hardcore sciences. That is really, you know, the basic experiments you do in a lab using robotics, but sometimes not using robotics, but using conventional experiments that you were running 30, 40 years ago. And this is really critical to really make sure that we sustain in the future a pool of really talented and very well-trained scientists who are willing to do the hardcore science that is a little bit still the mind of doing focused science that is sometimes long, very frustrating, with a lot of results that are not the ones expected. So it's and it's very difficult with the young generation, which is so used to get, you know, everything right away, being able to have the answers right away. And so it's very, very critical that you know, the young people in the audience think of really continuing in the path of science, because we need scientists for the future.
And for me, well, let's see. When I was 15, 16, 17, somewhere in there, I was a geek, right?
But geeks then, I was thinking about regretting it, like changing it, because no one liked geeks. There was Revenge of the Nerds, there was all of the, like, literally, it was not cool to be a scientist, an engineer, it wasn't any of that. But then wake up today, and I don't regret any of those things and all the BS I had to go through in high school or whatever else, because you get to change the world. You really, truly get to change the world for the better and change things. So I don't regret anything. And luckily now, geeks are really cool. They're in the media all the time. Geeks are changing the world. It's not just about sports and influencers, but geeks are changing the world. And so if you're a geek in 14, 15, 16, embrace it, because you can absolutely change the world. So if you are doing it or you're not doing it, you think it's cool to you, but nobody else thinks it's cool, screw them, go do it, because it's really cool when you get to change the world.
Well, we don't have an opportunity to ask the question to Sir Brian May, and what would be his point of view on his career, but there might be a chance to ask the question next year, because STARMUS 2024 is coming to Slovakia in May, and Professor Emmanuelle Charpentier and inventor Tony Fadell will be here at STARMUS, and all of you are invited. And I'm sure it's going to be a great event. Thank you very much for coming to the discussion or watching it online. And we are looking forward to the STARMUS itself.
Thank you.